So anyway, welcome. Today our presentation is going to be about native bee conservation, starting in your own backyard. Laren Leland is our speaker. Excellent. I thoroughly enjoyed visiting her at her place at the Yahats River. I think you'll enjoy the presentation. Laren?
About pronouncing Len. You can call me Leland, that's what I go by. It's a lot easier. How's that?
Is that too much?
That's good, I think. Can everybody see the projector? I do have a quiet voice, so I'll try to stay really close to the mic, and it's a little scratchy today, so I apologize about that. I identify as a native bee conservationist. I'm a former OSU Master Gardener, and I say former because I'm not actively participating in the program right now, but I have completed the program a few years ago, and I have done the volunteer work in Multnomah County. I never re-registered here in Lincoln County. It's a great program, and they have so much information if you ever need help with your gardening. I want to start by saying thank you for all of you for being here, because having people being interested in native bees, I believe, is the beginning of a paradigm shift for wanting to conserve and making really positive changes in the world. And so just by being here, you're contributing to that, and it's really important, and I'm very grateful to see you all. I also like to mention self-education is incredibly valid and incredibly important. I am not an entomologist, I'm not a biologist, I don't have any academic background in sciences. I have an MFA in fine art, and I'm a real estate broker now, so nothing that has to do with bees in my educational life, but it's my passion, and I have learned everything that I can, and I love to spread the word so that other people can also get excited about it. So if we're going to talk about native bee conservation, of course the most important thing to start with is who are native bees? And if you'll indulge me, I'd like to have a little tiny quiz so that I can kind of get a feeling of who's here and maybe what different people in the audience know about bees to start with. I would like all of you to not be shy and to just call out your answer to the next question, and please don't worry about being correct, because we're all here to learn, including me. How many bees do you see in this picture?
One.
Okay, so I hear a lot of different answers, which is what I thought would happen. And I'll tell you that there are two bees in this photo. We've got a bald-faced hornet, another hornet, a yellow jacket, a paper wasp, a honeybee, and a bumblebee. So my second question is, how many native insects are on this picture? There are two native insects in this photograph. The bald-faced hornet is native to the United States, and the bumblebee is native to the United States. Many times when I tell people that I have a native bee conservation farm, a sanctuary, people say, oh, do you sell honey? We don't sell honey because we don't have any honeybees. I am a beekeeper, and I love honeybees, and I think they're amazing creatures. We have bees at our Portland house, honeybees. But our project here is about conserving native bees. So just to give you a little bit more confidence in telling the difference, so all of the ones that are not bees are hornets or wasps. The only true hornet is the big one. Bald-faced hornets are actually are not actual hornets. They're just called that to confuse you. But all hornets are wasps, but not all wasps are hornets. So don't worry about that too much. But that's good information. To help you be more confident to tell the difference between wasps and bees, because a lot of people get stung and they say, "Oh, I got stung 4 times by this crazy bee," and I say, "Well, if you got stung 4 times by the same insect, it was probably actually a wasp and not a bee." So wasps will eat insects, pollen, and nectar. I think that's a photo of a bee, a wasp eating a caterpillar. They're hairless and shiny. They have a very well-defined waist. Right there, you can see. They can sting many times because they don't lose their stinger when they sting you. And they do occasionally pollinate. They are also pollinators. They have a really interesting relationship to figs. There's over 900 species of figs, and there's over 900 species of tiny little wasps that pollinate them. And they have a really interesting mutualism where they can't survive without each other. And if you're interested in that, I could talk about that for a long time, but we don't have time. They also parasitize other organisms, which is really gruesome. It's one of those nature things that really spooks me out. They lay eggs in caterpillars, and then the caterpillars hatch, and they eat the caterpillars. Oh, it's really gross. Anyways, bees, on the other hand, especially, I call bumblebees the teddy bears of the bee world because they're so cute and fuzzy and adorable. Like that picture right there. They eat pollen and nectar. So pollen is primarily a protein source for bees, and social bees, like honeybees or bumblebees, will collect pollen and mix it with their saliva and make something called bee bread, and that's how they have protein. The nectar is more for flight energy. It's a really quick source of energy, like drinking juice. They're fuzzy. The fur that covers their body helps them pick up pollen. They sting only once. So they have a barbed stinger, with the exception of queen honeybees. They can sting multiple times, and that's specifically because they use it to sting other queen bees in order to kill them before, so they can be the one that's in the nest. But queen, you're not often going to get stung by a queen bee anyways. And bees are amazing pollinators. Honeybees are actually not as good at pollinating as our native bees are. There are so many different kinds of native bees. There are over 4,000 species in the United States. Our native bees include bumblebees, mining bees, mason bees, sweat bees, leafcutter bees, carpenter bees, cuckoo bees, the list goes on and on. And this poster does a really great job of showing you the variety of the body shapes and colors and sizes. This is another really great thing to look at. It kind of gives you, I don't have time to go into all the details about the differences between the different types of bees in this presentation, but on the left here, it gives you an example of three bumblebees and how they're different. And then sweat bees are in the middle, and they're called that because sometimes they land on humans and actually drink, or animals, and drink sweat. And then mason bees, carpenter bees, longhorn bees, and you can kind of get an overview of like different body shapes from this, which is great. It was a pamphlet that was put out by Portland Parks to describe the bees people might see in the parks in Portland. But to give you an idea of how many bumblebees there are, this is just the bumblebees that are in the western United States. And here in the Pacific Northwest, we have 16. So, the most endangered in this area, I don't know, off the top of my head. I think I do know, and I'm just blanking because it's not like on my script, but. So we have 16 just in the Pacific Northwest, and as you can see, they look very similar. So sometimes it can be extremely hard, especially as somebody who's not trained as an entomologist, to tell them apart. The bee that I see the most around here is this one right here. It's Bombus vulscanetsky, I think it's pronounced, and it's, the common name is the yellow-faced bumblebee. That one is extremely common. And it looks very similar to some of the other bees. So if you really want to get into identifying, these are all the different bumblebee body parts that you can learn about. And some of the bumblebees, you know, the only difference is that some of the segments are different colors. The yellow-faced bumblebee looks a lot like a different bumblebee that is endangered, whose name I'm blanking on right now. The only difference between the two is that the one that is endangered has a few yellow hairs on its belly, and the yellow-faced bumblebee does not. So it can be very specific. If you would like further help with identification, these are two really good books. The Bees in Your Backyard is actually on that table over there. It's my personal book, but I brought it in case you wanted to leaf through it. And Bumblebees in North America. If you are up on technology, you can download an app called the Bumblebee Watch, and you actually take pictures of these and you upload them, and then they have experts look at it and help you identify it. iNaturalist is a great project here in the Cape Perpetua area. There's something called the Cape Perpetua BioBlitz, which is a fancy way to say our area. You can upload any kind of species, plants or animals, and then other people will either agree or disagree with your identification, and it's a great way to know what other people are seeing and, you know, what's out there. And then on Facebook, for better or worse, it's a really great networking tool, and there's groups. So Insect Identification has 42,000 members. So if you upload something there, it's pretty likely that somebody's gonna have an idea about what it is. There's a North American native bee, bumblebee conservation enthusiasts. And then in order to try to get the conversation going here, I started this group called Central Oregon Coast Organic Gardening and Pollinators. One thing I should mention is that I'm gonna have this entire slideshow available for download, so don't stress out about taking notes, and if I go fast, you just let it kind of wash over you and you can catch up with the information later. So now you know a little bit about who the native bees are, and let's talk about why they are important. I'd say the main reason is that they're great pollinators. And then the second reason, of course, is that they're a vital part of our ecosystem. They fill a niche, and every species that exists is incredibly important because over generations and decades and thousands of years, these mutualistic relationships have formed, and we all support each other, you know, or we should. Maybe our species isn't really doing our job. So if you think back to high school, maybe, or college, your pollination biology information that you got, pollination is how flowering, oh, I don't know what just happened. Pollination is how flowering plants become fertilized, and that leads to seed production and reproduction. So compatible pollen must move from the anther, which is the male reproductive organ, to the female reproductive organ, which is the stigma. And in self-fertilizing plants, that can happen within the same flower. But in cross-pollinating plants, you need a pollinator to connect one flower to the other, the same species. So the reason that native bees are so incredibly vital is that it's not just about the species of bees themselves, which I believe all species have a right to exist, but beyond that, if we don't have native bees, we're going to have fewer plants. If we have even reduced amounts of native bees, we're going to have less diversity in our plants, and that means less food, and that means less life on the planet. So it's not just a small issue of these species are important because of them themselves, but it's the ripple effect that it's caused with just contributing to a worse, poorer and poorer environment. I want to take a moment to mention that bees and wasps are not the only pollinators. I love this image because it shows that there's bees, bats, butterflies, moths, flies, wasps, beetles, birds, possums, and I would add humans to that list because, especially in China where all the pollinators are dead, humans are doing pollinating there. If you look that up, there's striking images of people. I'm going to ask you to hold your questions until the end. I'm sorry I should have said it at the beginning, but thank you for having something to contribute. If you look it up online, there's really striking images of people climbing into fruit trees to pollinate, and I've heard that there's even an underground pollen tree, which is funny and sad. So the next question of conservation is, we know who they are, we know why they're important, and why do they need our help? I think you probably all remember the Wilsonville incident where 25,000 bumblebees were found dead on the parking lot floor. It was determined by the Xerces Society, who we'll talk about more later, that there were some linden trees nearby that had been sprayed with pesticides while the bees were flying, which is illegal and shouldn't have happened, and that's what happened in that one instance. So challenges, they have lots of challenges. Pesticides are designed to kill insects, and pesticides don't discriminate between different types of insects. They just, bottom line, they shouldn't be used when pollinators are present. But also a loss of habitat from urban sprawl, from farmers doing monoculture instead of having diverse, biodiverse landscapes like we used to have before herbicides and pesticides were so utilized. And also with monoculture, it might look like there's a lot of food in a field of just almonds, but it's like if we only ate white bread, if we only had one source of something that we're eating, we wouldn't be healthy. Bees need a diverse diet as well. And as a side note, specifically almonds are even slightly toxic for bees, so when they're carting thousands of bees all over the country in crates on semi-trucks to pollinate the almonds, not only are they spreading disease between all those honeybees, but they're also feeding them a really poor diet, poor, slightly toxic diet, and they're taking their honey away and feeding them sugar instead. So that's honeybee specific, but it also happens with bumblebees. And a lot of people, most people, I don't think know this. I didn't find this out until I read a book by David Gold, who I'll talk about later. But there are actual commercial production happening of bumblebee nests as well. And that's because inside greenhouses, when you're growing tomatoes, bumblebees are really the best pollinator. And so the bumblebees are produced in overcrowded situations, and diseases spread, and then they're shipped all over the country. And that's also decimating bumblebee populations. As a side note, it's really cool how bumblebees pollinate tomatoes. Tomatoes don't let go of their pollen unless a bumblebee latches on with their mandibles and buzzes their wings. It's called buzz pollination. And the pollen kind of falls out onto the bee. And you can also replicate this at home with an electric toothbrush. Pesticides are also hidden in pre-treated plants. Now, this is a huge point. There's a class of pesticides called neonicotinoids, or you can say neonics for short if it's easier. This is a tag that actually tells you that it's protected from all these things by neonicotinoids, but what it doesn't say is that it's harmful to pollinators. And most of the time, they're not labeled. They're not labeled at all. So you go to the store and you think that you're buying something to help pollinators, but instead you are putting something in your garden that is going to continue to produce pesticides for years to come. So my advice for you, if you're willing to take the challenge, is to ask every single supplier that you work with if they use neonicotinoids or not. This means the seeds that you buy, if you're buying online, if you're buying in person. If you want to be a little bit less confrontational, you can say, hey, which of your plants are safe from bees and for bees and don't have neonicotinoids? Or if you want to kind of make a point of it like I do, you can load up your entire cart with all the things you want to buy, and then when you get to the checkout, you can say, oh, by the way, do any of these have neonicotinoids? And make the entire line of people behind you wait and like see the scene that's happening where the person checking you out is really fault. I mean, it's not their fault necessarily, I know, but then they have to go do research and figure out who their suppliers are, and it's just a way to sort of protest, I would say, and just put yourself in a place where you're like, hey, I'm not going to leave until you tell me if these plants are safe, and by the way, this information should already be provided, and by the way, why are you selling unsafe things to begin with? That's my little soapbox for the moment. So they don't kill automatically, like right when the bee goes to the flower. However, they do cause neurological damage, and they do cause a decrease in egg-laying ability. So you don't need to be a scientist to know that that is going to cause horrible repercussions down the line. The way that scientists test pesticides to see if they can be used or not is they take the bee and they spray it with the pesticide, and then they watch the bee, and if it doesn't die within some certain amount of time, then they declare that it can be used for plants, and that is not the only way that a pesticide can harm a bee. We're done with all the bad news. You can take a deep breath. I'm going to calm down a little bit. And we're going to talk about all the ways that you can help. So, the best way to help, the easiest way to help, things that you're probably doing anyways, is to provide a garden, a place for bees to get food. And you can provide safe forage by buying organic, because organic is not allowed to have pesticides on it, or you can even buy things that aren't organic as long as they're not treated with those specific pesticides. You can practice integrated pest management, and that's not something I have time to get into in this presentation, but it's basically, it talks about a spectrum of ways to deal with problems in the garden. So if something's happening that you need to address, start with the least toxic way and then move towards the chemical side if there's no other ways to deal with it. I'll tell you from gardening experience that most of your problems are not with whatever you're seeing, but they're in the soil. And if you feed the soil and make it really rich and full of food for the plants, then you're not going to have very many pest issues to begin with. You can provide safe water, which I'll have a slide about, create habitat, spread the word and help others to take these steps. I mean, just tell all of your friends about how to buy safe plants, and just doing that would make a huge impact. And then you can also get involved to help on a larger scale, of course. So if you would like to host native bees, there's a few specific ways to do this. Mason bees, does anybody host mason bees already? A few of you? I have a couple books over there you can take a look at. This little girl here, this is a mason bee. They're pretty adorable, although some people mistake them for flies, understandably. As a side note, flies have two wings and bees have four, so that's one way to tell the difference. This is the mason bee house I have in Portland. It is made up of a stack of wood pieces that have holes in them. And I like it slightly better than the ones that just have drilled holes, because you can take this apart and clean it out if it gets like overwhelmed with gross stuff. Basically, these are just tubes, and you can either get, you can do it with bamboo, or with reeds, or this is probably a commercial cardboard. And those also, some people like to harvest the cocoons in October, bring them in for the winter, and then put them back out when they're going to come out in spring, and keeping them in the refrigerator. There's two schools of thought on this. One is that you're saving them from predation and being parasitized, but the other school of thought is maybe you're gonna be selecting for bees that aren't gonna be able to take care of themselves in the long term, so you kind of have to decide how you feel about that. This is what it looks like inside one of the tubes. So each bee will lay an egg, they'll collect pollen, and then they'll build a little wall out of mud, and that's why they're called mason bees, until they fill up the entire tube. And then in the spring, they come out one at a time. So as a side note, if you have the mason bee house facing in one cardinal direction and you switch it around, you could damage the bees, because they are programmed to kind of come out the same way that they get confused. And if you're going to build a house, it's important to do it 6 to 8 inches deep, because scientists have found that they lay the female bees the deepest in order to protect them more, because they're the egg layers. And if you do 4 inches deep, you'll probably only get male bees. And then for mason bees, around 8 millimeters wide, a little bit less or more is good. Leafcutter bees, these little guys are so fascinating. If you see something like this on your plants, that probably means you have leafcutter bees in the area. They just cut this amazingly perfect circle with their jaws, and they buzz around with it. I know that they are propelling the leaf, but it always looks to me like they're flying on a rocket ship. I really like it. And you can actually buy the cocoons at crownbee.com. Crownbee.com is a good source for them. I think they have mason bees too. You can also get a pheromone and try to attract them naturally. For these, if you're right on the coast, it probably won't work, because they need it to be over 70 degrees for the amount of time that they're not in their cocoons. These are some examples of some really fancy bug houses. You can make it pretty. It doesn't have to be ugly. Cute little bee up there. This is in France, actually. They're a little bit ahead of us. I don't think we have... I don't know anything like this in our public parks, but if you do, please let me know. And then bumblebees, they're a little bit harder to host. They're really picky about where they live. So there are instructions online from the Xerces Society about how to set up a bumblebee house, but only about 30% of them will actually get utilized. They really like to live in places that have previously been inhabited by either birds or mice, some kind of small creature like that. So in Portland, we're on a swarm list to kind of get calls whenever there's a honeybee swarm, right? So we got this call one time, and the woman said, we have a bird's nest, and there's bees in it. And I was like, that's probably bumblebees, but I'll come out and take a look. And it was. It was this birdhouse, and it had bumblebees in it, and she just was so worried about them stinging her kids. So I said, I'd be happy to take it. I took it home, and we had this cute little bumblebee bird nest in our backyard. If you stumble upon them in nature, this is more what it would look like after it's been uncovered. This is bumblebees, and they don't have honey like honeybees do, but they do collect nectar, and they store it in pots for 3 to 4 days. So the nectar would probably go bad after a while because they don't. Honeybees do something where they dehydrate the honey, basically, and once the water content gets down to a certain level, then it can subsist for thousands of years. They found Egyptian tombs that still have edible honey in it. So, solitary ground bees. So 70% of our native bees are actually solitary ground bees. And the way to provide habitat for them is to have open dirt areas. And this is, I mean, I think it looks beautiful and natural to have plants with just exposed dirt on the bottom. We added compost. This is my house in Portland. We added compost every year, but they don't mind the compost. This is what their little holes look like. You might already have them in your garden if you have areas of dirt. And this is a little ground bee right here. Bee water. So if you have like a bird bath, you're gonna drown bees. They can't drink from that. It's too much water in one place. But if you have rocks, which mineralize the water for them, or moss, which they really love drinking out of, I'm sure it adds something for them too, you will make some bees happy. And you can help by gardening. So talking about plants, we don't have time to go through all of this, but be showy. Flowers should bloom in your garden throughout the growing season. So you don't want to just provide a lot of food for 2 months. You want it to stretch for as much of the year as you can. And really, as gardeners, we want to have flowers as often as we can anyways, right? So it's not an issue. Be bountiful. The best way to do it is to plant really big patches of the same species. And if you think about this from a bee's perspective, if they're focusing on one type of flower, it saves them a lot of energy if the flowers are close together. They don't have to fly from one side of your garden to the other side to get the same species. And then be a little messy. So if you leave things like piles of sticks and open ground with dirt, you know, basically the more natural you can make it, the better it's going to be. Floral fidelity is one of my favorite phrases in bee science. It means, for example, a colony of bumblebees, the colony itself will visit lots of different types of flowers, and the diversity is important. But each individual bee will specialize in a certain flower until that resource has been tapped. And bees, it's really cute, they actually become specialists on certain types of flowers, because if you think about how diverse flowers are, think about, do you all know what snapdragons are? So when you look at them, there's no way to enter the flower. So the bees actually have to land on the bottom part, pull it down, and then crawl in. And that's something they have to learn. They're not born knowing how to do that. So if you watch like a bee who's never approached a snapdragon before, it takes them a while to figure it out. And then if you watch bees who've been doing it for a while, they're pros. And research shows that if a native bee disappears from a site, the remaining native bees will visit a broader range of flowers. And that means that the floral fidelity of the bees in that space has been lowered. And if you can imagine, if they're going to a broader range of species, then there's less pollen going from the same species to the same species, and therefore pollination and their ability for the plants to reproduce is being impacted. Plant selection, I love talking about this. So the two main questions with selecting plants for bees is, how do you choose plants that are going to bloom the entire season, and which plants provide the best forage? So for bloom selection, there are actually calendars for this, which is, I was just like, when I was starting to think about this, I was like, there's got to be a way, there's got to be like something out there, like a chart or a graph. And then when I finally did a lot of Googling, I was like, oh, bloom calendars, it is a thing. People have thought of this. Okay, great. So this is from the Xerces Society, and it's for the Pacific Northwest. And as you can see, if you had all of these plants, you would have something in your garden blooming from March until the end of October. And I think we can even do better here. There are plants that will go even farther than that. If you want to see what some of these plants look like, this is a photo of all plants that were on the previous slide. I've heard gardeners say things like, oh, native plants are so boring, I really like exotics, and I do too. I'm not saying that there isn't a place for that. However, I would like to have you all think about when this country was discovered by white people, plants from here were actually like the most exotic thing anybody in Europe had ever seen. So it all depends on your perspective, of course. And you know, native plants, they belong here, and they are a lot more sustainable to grow. You have to water them a lot less because they're made to live here. And the reason it says native-ish is because these are all from the West Coast, but I wouldn't say they're all from like this Cape Petrella area right here necessarily. But they're beautiful. Showy milkweed, I'll point out specifically, is one of the seed packets that I have available, and it's the host plant for monarch butterflies, so that's an extra little bonus for that. We do get monarchs migrating through here. This is a bloom chart that was made by the Concerned Citizens for Clean Air. Hopefully you're all familiar with their project. They've been keeping yahats from Newport free of herbicides for the last 10 years, which is amazing. And they did this survey of what is there. It's more pages than this. This is just the first section. They are kind of switching over to a new organization called the Pollinator Restoration Project, Central Oregon Coast, which I'll talk about a little bit later. So this is sort of a survey to see what we already have on the Central Oregon Coast, Highway 101, as far as native pollinator plants goes. And this is one of my favorite books. I have it over there if you want to take a look at it, Victory Gardens for Bees. What I love about it is that it not only does it tell you about plants that are great for bees, but it even tells you what kind of bees will go to it and what other beneficial insects will go to the same plant too. It's really specific information, and I appreciate that. One of the ones that it points out is borage, which is another seed pack that I have for you. It's not native, but it is a great European herb. And she says that it refills with nectar every 2 minutes. So there's this book by David Gold, who's an amazing bee researcher, and he talks about how bees can actually smell chemical imprint on flowers that have been left from visitors that came before, and they can tell how long it's been since there was a visitor at that flower based on this chemical imprint. And the bees learn over time how long each different flower takes to refill with nectar. So then if you ever see a bee that's hovering in front of a flower and then it chooses to go to a different one, it's because they've noticed, oh hey, somebody has been here too recently, it's not going to have any nectar for me. And that really helps with their efficiency because they're not landing and taking off all the time on flowers that don't have anything for them.
Wow.
Yeah, wow. So general groups of good forage plants, I'm just going to say it over and over again, flowering native plants. But also blossoms of food plants in general. There's exceptions to all rules. These are not steadfast rules. But many fruits and veggies are great for bees. Herbs and flowering medicinal plants, especially mint. Somebody was talking about mint earlier today for me. And I want to point out that they're medicinal for us, but they're medicinal for the bees too. Willows, maples, deciduous trees in general, usually flower and produce some sort of pollen or nectar that bees want. And there's a bunch of large flowering trees and shrubs that specifically have a high pollen and nectar count, and I'll have that list later on. One really important thing to note is that any heirloom plant is generally going to have a lot better food for pollinators than anything that's been improved or hybridized by us. When humans set out to improve, air quotes, plants, they often do it on a basis of what they consider beauty and aesthetics, and not on a basis of what's good for the environment or what's good for plants or animals or anybody else. And so if you look at this from a bee's perspective, there's a lot of different areas to land here and to get food. And here, there's not even any way to access. So it's totally useless, except for aesthetically. And then there's some plants that may look like flowering plants, or some flowering plants in general that just don't provide food at all. So this hydrangea on the left looks like it has really big, beautiful blossoms. But these are actually leaves that have been modified by the plant to just look like that. Whereas this hydrangea on the right is called a lace cap, and that is actually a bunch of little flowers in the middle. So if you were at the nursery, I would hope that you would between the two would pick the one that is actually doing some good for the pollinators instead of just looking pretty. And then there's a lot of plants that are wind pollinated. Spinach, chard, beets, grasses, hardwood trees, pines, spruces, and firs. As a side note, conifers are good for honeybees because they provide propolis. It's a resin that they collect that is medicinal for them. And some plants can even be toxic to bees. One example is silver linden is toxic, whereas little leaf linden is a great bee plant. So if you're planting for pollinators, you just might want to do a little bit of research about what you're planting to make sure you're doing the right thing. Here's some more great native plants, just because they're beautiful and want to share them with you. Ceanothus is always just covered in bees. Ocean spray, Nutcaroos, Douglas aster, which those are blooming right now. Red flowering currant, Oregon grape. Let your veggies flower. You know, we, as gardeners, sometimes we're a little too neat and tidy, and we just cut everything down for fall. But at the end of the season, or in the middle of the season, if you're moving on to a new bed, let them flower. I mean, I can't tell you how many pollinators I see of these, and hummingbirds love them. This is just, you know, your brassicas. Just let them go. Crocus, it's not native, but it's an amazing early food source, and they're beautiful. And you can plant them inside a lawn and just wait till they're done blooming and then mow. So it's a great way to add pollinator food to a lawn, which lawns aren't really doing much of anything for anyone. I love this photo because there's a honeybee and two different types of bumblebee on this little tiny patch. And you can tell there's just not that much out there for them at that time of year. Crimson clover is a great bee plant, and it's also a wonderful permaculture plant because you can plant it as a cover crop and then feed the bees. And then after it's done, you can actually chop it into the soil, and it provides more fertility for your soil. Herbs. Comfrey, rosemary, lavender. I love the story about comfrey because it's hard for insects to get into the flower, so a lot of times bumblebees will come in at the side and poke a hole right where the nectar comes out. It's called nectar sealing. And it's funny because the bumblebees will do that and they'll drink from it, and then honeybees can't get into the flower themselves, but they will go and they will use the bumblebee hole if the bumblebee has already made it. And then weeds, the things that we call weeds, I should say. There's so many beautiful flowers that we think badly of, and I really don't understand it. I suspect that it has something to do with the chemical companies wanting us to weed and feed our lawns and kill our medicine so that we have to rely on chemicals instead of on our native, like on our medicine that's growing in our gardens. Dandelion's beautiful, and I hear so many people, especially women, say, oh, I'd love to leave the dandelions, but my husband would never let me. Just like, let's move on from that. Like, let's let the dandelions bloom. They're beautiful. The roots are a coffee substitute. They're edible. I mean, there's only good things you can say about dandelions, really. Dead nettle is also edible, and Queen Anne's lace is a wild carrot, and it's very attractive to pollinators. This is my list of trees that grow in this area, right by the coast. You're probably not going to get away with all of them, but if you're a little bit inland, again, you can get this list from me later. But these are great trees. Consider doing a pollinator lawn instead of a grass lawn. This grass over here needs to be maintained by mowing, and it needs to be watered properly if you want it to stay green. This pollinator lawn has so much food for pollinators. It's beautiful. Blooms it all throughout the year, and most of the flowers in there are native. So, people and organizations. How's the end of the plant section? The Xerces Society is definitely the first one I would talk about because they do so much great work. They're an international nonprofit. These are just two of their books, but they have so many informational resources, from PDFs that you can download to books, all kinds of things. They're actually based in Portland, even though they're an international organization, which is really cool. And they protect wildlife through the conservation of invertebrates. It's not just bees, but bees are a lot of what they do. And just as a little cute side note, their name comes from the now extinct Xerces blue butterfly, which was the first butterfly known to go extinct in North America due to human activities. And David Gould, I'm sure you've heard me mention him a few times during this talk. He's kind of my hero. He's actually exchanged emails with me. he's an author. He founded the Bumblebee Conservation Trust, which is in England. They are a lot more knowledgeable, and bumblebees are a lot more well-known in England for some reason. People are just really wild for them. It's a whole thing. This book here called A Buzz in the Meadow, that book, is a really great source of information about meadow restoration and creation, which isn't something there's very much, you can't learn very much about that in the United States for some reason. It's not something people do. My partner and I are interested in changing 10 acres of our hay fields, because we're not big animal people, into a biodiverse meadow, and just even trying to figure out how to do that without the use of glyphosate, because we don't want to use herbicide. It's a difficult process, and anyways, his book talks about a French farm that he bought where he did this successfully. These are, Pollinator Partnership is another 501c3 dedicated to pollinators. They have projects like the North American Pollinator Protection Campaign, National Pollinator Week, and they provide eco-regional planting guides. They also have an app called Bee Smart, which it helps you figure out what to plant in your pollinator garden. And then there's some local projects I would like to highlight. The first, I already mentioned, the Pollinator Restoration Project, which is growing out of Concerned Citizens for Clean Air. The Pollinator Restoration Project Central Oregon Coast is a citizen group working with ODOT and Lincoln County to help restore the pollinator habitat of the 101 Highway Corridor from Yahats to Newport. We're really excited about it, and we need people to help. It's just starting, so if you would like to contribute time and energy, kind of the scope of the project is to encourage any native plants that are already there, remove invasive weeds, add more native plants, and generally raise awareness about pollinators and make our highway more beautiful. It's all good, right? I have some photos of what the highway looks like now. There's actually a lot of pollinator stuff happening already. This is a native plant called fireweed, which you probably see up and down 101 all the time. In the foreground and in the background, you've got willows. And like I said before, willows are a really great early resource for pollinator food. And then this might look just like a bunch of weeds to some people, but there's a lot going on here, actually. This little yellow plant is not native, but it's called birdsfoot trefoil, and it's a great source of protein for insects. This is Pearly Everlasting, which is a native plant and is a good pollinator resource. And this pink stuff is spirea, and it is native as well. So just in this one little spot along 101, you just have a very diverse palette of flowers for bees happening already. Part of the project also is convincing ODOT, well, to keep not spraying, except if there's like a really, really horrible invasive, it's okay for them to spot spray, but we don't want like a broadcast spraying because it affects people and so many things negatively and gets into the water. But also, to keep them from mowing and having them mow really early in the year and really late in the year, but letting everything grow in between so that things that are trying to grow are not destroyed. And then this is my last photo. This was, my friend Maxine and I went on, we took some photos. This is evening primrose. And just to give you an idea of how beautiful it could be if our 101 corridor was filled with wildflowers. And then Blossomwood Farmstead, this is actually where I live, and my partner and I manage it. We had a dream, we moved here from Portland to sort of just continue to be here more often so we could actually make it happen. It's 42 acres, we're right 7 miles up Yahats River Road. This is our farm. If you've ever been up Yahats River Road, you might have seen it because it's pretty visible. If you hit the fork, you've just gone past us, we're on the left or before that. And so our project is just adding as much forage as we can, and we're really excited. There's two scientists coming from the OSVB lab in early November to see if they can set up a research station on our farm. They have a world-class, mostly honeybees, but also native bee lab at OSU. So we're doing our best to not do anything about the weeds. this is a common yarrow, which is it kind of seems to attract more flies than bees, honestly, but flies are pollinators too. And then birdsfoot trefoil, which we have a lot of. And then this is something we added, it's a salvia sage. And you know, the digitalis foxglove is also not native, but it's naturalized and it's a great bumblebee plant and other pollinators too. And then these are just some bees that I've seen on our farm. So the top three, I think these are all yellow-faced bumblebees. This is a queen. See how huge she is? This is a native sweat bee. It's green. I was picking up some dirt in the garden, and I destroyed the nest, unfortunately, but got to see her. This is a little, I think she might be a sweat bee too. Like I said, I'm not an entomologist, I'm not an expert at identifying, but that's what it looks like to me. And then this is a Queen Anne's lace, and it's got this bluish green metallic bee, a ladybug, and a moth all having like this little pollinator party. and I have an upcoming class. If you didn't learn enough today, or if you want to hear more about it, I'm talking about bees and butterflies, so there'll be a little bit less about bees and then more information about butterflies on Saturday, October 28th at 11 a.m. at the Cape Perpetua Visitor Center. And thank you again for being here. Thank you for your interest. I'm open to some questions, and I've got purple coneflower borage showing milkweed to hand out if you'd like any seeds to start your garden or add to your garden. Thank you. So the question is, how do we protect the mason bee nests from rain, if we get tons of rain here? One way would be to hang it up in some kind of a protected area, like if you have an outdoor gazebo, that would be a great place. Some of the mason bee houses come with little roofs on them, and so if you're worried about that, you could extend it farther. I would definitely always put a roof on it so the rain isn't falling right into their openings. So that would be two great ways.
Okay. Thank you. I was in Slovenia some time ago, and they had a Carpathian Mountains, I'm not sure I'm pronouncing it right, and they talk about 1800s, how they developed the bee hive, and then they transported them or brought them to countries all over the world. Are most honeybees from that dissemination? They brought them to the United States, and you're saying we don't have native honeybees, at least not here by virtue.
We don't have native bees currently in the fossil record. There have been honeybees in the United States, but the honeybees we have now are not related to them. The honeybees that we have are mostly from when the colonists first came here. They brought bees, and the indigenous people actually called them white man's fly. but there are different species of honeybees. You've probably all heard of killer bees before. So this is an interesting history. Which kind of parallels human history in a way. So Africanized bees are more aggressive than European bees, and they actually use a different type of hive style that is horizontal instead of vertical. It's called the top bar hive. It's actually what we have used as beekeepers. But and African people have worked with these honeybees and have gotten honey from them for, you know, a long time. But scientists took Africanized bees from Africa to South America and tried to mate them with European honeybees in the lab. And the bees that came out of that were even more aggressive than the Africanized bees. And of course, they escaped the lab. And then they started moving north towards the United States. And that's when we got all the crazy media about killer bees. Those were what those bees were. They were lab created from an African and European strain. So I find it really interesting that Africanized bees are called killer bees. European bees are the ones that everybody's crazy about saving, and the indigenous bees are the ones that are being displaced that we actually should be working on saving. Paul?
Your metal project, I think that there would be a good partnership with the Forest Service because there's some funds related to the stewardship program that would be applicable for that. So I can talk to you later about that.
Yes, please.
Great opportunity.
Thank you.
No pollinators from China?
Certain parts of China. I'm sorry, China is huge, and of course there are tons of pollinators in China, but there are specific areas where they have, at least there's not enough in order for trees to be pollinated.
How would that happen?
Chemicals, pollution, mostly.
A lot of habitat?
Yeah. All of that. Yeah. I mean, it's hard for humans to breathe there, so. You know, the whole canary in the coal mine thing, when you're that small, the pollution affects you a lot more than when you're as large as we are. So it's really sad. It's you know, I hope that it scares people enough that they want to do something to not have that happen here.
I think a lot of, to me, you know, there's all this talk of invasive species, and I just kind of sort of remind myself that we are probably the most invasive species.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm a writer in addition to everything else I do, and I'm working on a piece now where I'm thinking about the words naturalized and the words native and the words indigenous and the words, all of those things, and about how colonialism specifically is very invasive, maybe the epitome of what invasiveness is, and how if we could learn from naturalized plants that offer something, offer a gift in exchange and don't displace anybody else and don't misbehave, that maybe we would be better as a species. Sorry, let me go in front of you.
Oh, thank you, Paul. It's my understanding the rusty patch bumblebee is the one the most endangered.
Thank you.
And it is a native here in Oregon, also back east. And one of the other big factors in Oregon is the Oregon Forestry Practices Act, to where they use chemicals to kill the native species. And I think that's going to make a huge impact on our pollinators in Oregon.
Yeah. I want to say thank you to everybody who voted against aerial spraying while we're on the topic, because that is beneficial for Oregon.
So what is the difference between a naturalized species and an invasive species, besides the time frame in which it happened?
There's a lot of different answers to that. Mostly it's how humans view them. They're all non-native, but invasive species, usually it's defined as something that is creating an issue for other species or for humans. Well, humans are other species, but if they're creating some sort of an issue by displacement. So if you think about kudzu, have you heard of the kudzu vine? Like, that's considered invasive because it's displacing so many other things. And I would say, like, ivy, you know, if you introduce English ivy to a forested area, it'll grow up the trees, it'll grow over the ground, and it knocks out the space that other species were using. So, but, you know, when you think about honeybees, they could be considered invasive, potentially, because they definitely decrease the amount of food for native bees. So, but you don't hear about native bees, honeybees being called invasive because they're useful to us, because we get honey and pollination from them, and it's really, I don't think there's an actual scientific definition. I think it's more of like word usage.
So one question that I always come to in these discussions is, what is the rationale for using chemicals to kill something that's considered invasive, which, as you say, is our perspective on things rather than anything else? I mean, what is the trade-off that you make when you decide to use chemicals to kill or try to kill a species? It generally doesn't even work. And versus, on the other hand, this species is going to dominate more in this area where it wasn't before. But there's competition between species all the time. So how do you justify?
Well, I don't justify the use of chemicals personally. But I think other people justify the use of chemicals because
right.
if something's invasive, and I think it's the potential for how much it could take over. And if you have, like, say, Japanese knotweed taking over the entire Highway 101, that's going to have a negative impact, because even though knotweed is a great pollinator plant, it only blooms at a specific time. So it's going to have an adverse effect on a cascading scale if it's let loose.
Yeah, well, there's Japanese knotweed at 10 Mile, where I live, 7 miles south of here, and it's definitely taking over the area that constantly gets disturbed by flooding in the spring and winter. But so what is the point of adding poison to that problem? It doesn't get rid of it.
I don't advocate it.
No, I'm not saying that you do.
Yes.
But I don't understand that decision.
Yeah, I don't either. Yeah. Did Paul have something?
Yeah, Paul. I have a little more reality check. Is China. We're right behind them. They tested honey, and there's 60-70% pesticides present in honey, commercial honey. I mean, we've got an agricultural model that's in commercial.
control of our landscape. And they're using this thing on a ramp to scale. It's unbelievable.
I'm completely different topic, but still related to bees. When you talk about, I work with young kids, and when we talk about studying bees, I always have parents and administrators asking about bee stings and allergies. I don't have any idea whether bumblebees are even an issue that way.
Bumblebees will sting if they get caught in your clothing, if you put your hand down on them, if you're around their nest. But all bees really don't want to sting you because they lose their stinger.
No, I understand that. Yeah. I teach the kids. The only time I've been stung is when I stepped on one or got stuck in my field hockey shin guard. What I mean is allergies. You know how we.
Oh, yes, yeah. Bumblebees are also.
Yeah,
they're also going to create the same. The interesting thing about allergies is that a lot of people say that they're allergic to bee stings, and it turns out that having a large local reaction is normal. It's considered a normal reaction, and I have really large, really uncomfortable, horrible reactions to bee stings. However, I've never gone into anaphylactic shock, and I've never gotten hives on my body in a place other than the actual place where the bee sting is. And those are the things that actually tell you that you're allergic. Because if you have anaphylactic shock or you have a physical reaction in a site other than where the bee sting is itself.
I have another question. I had a gentleman that wanted to put a beehive on my property.
Mm-hmm.
And I was kind of leaning towards it, so maybe I didn't.
No, and don't get me wrong, I think honeybees are great, and I think supporting local beekeepers that have really holistic practices especially is an important thing to do. I mostly have an issue with commercial beekeeping because they're treated like livestock, and like all livestock in our country, it's a really sad situation. And one beehive probably won't, if you have 100 beehives, that would have a huge negative impact. There's actually, and I don't know exactly what the threshold is, but there's actually this interesting thing that happens when you have a few, when you have like one or two honeybee hives, they can actually stimulate the plants to create more pollen and nectar because they're being visited more, and it can actually be helpful to the ecology of the area. But there's like a threshold when, like, of course, everybody in our society, if two is great, 50 is better, and I don't know where that is, you know, where the threshold is. I haven't been able, I don't have access to academics, papers, which is kind of horrible because I would know so much more if I did. But I'm sure somebody somewhere knows what the threshold is, but I don't know that in particular. But I think adding one or two is a great thing to do.
Two more questions, and then you can talk to her afterwards.
There's a sheet of resources, and at the bottom it has my website address, and it's not up there yet, but I will get up there very soon. And there's a lot more resources there than what's on the list, too.
So my question is, I don't know very much about the bees in my property. Is there a time of day I can go out there and really start counting to see if I added flowers, for instance, I increased it? I'm just not trying to be a scientist here, but...
Citizen science is really awesome, too. It's kind of late in the year now because it's getting kind of cold and rainy, but you can still see a few. But they like the sun. You're going to find them in the sun. That's where you're going to find them. Yeah, depending on the species of bee, at a certain temperature, they can't move their wings. So if it's above that temperature, and the higher it goes to a certain point, of course, the faster they can fly, and the better their body works. So you'll see them in the sun.
Thank you so much for coming in.